Welcome guys, in this tutorial we are going to perform some data flow management task using NiFi. So what we are going to do is, I have listed all the tasks which we are going to perform in this tutorial. So step one will be reading a file. I have already downloaded a sample file which is called employee.csv. And I also have another file which is called country.csv. So employee.csv contains employee related information, and also it contains location ID. So using that location ID, we'll be filling the country name for each of the employees. So let me show you the data which I have right now. So I'm in the home directory, and if I do ls, you can see there is a directory called raw data here. So inside raw data, I have copied employee.csv. So if you see records of employee.csv, you will see this structure. So it has gender, name, and location ID. And then I have another file which is called country.csv, as you can see here. So let's see the content of country.csv. So you can see country.csv is having codes, and along with the codes, it is having the full description or full name of the country. So our goal is to perform a lookup, which is also, you know, kind of joining or also commonly known as lookup, to enrich the data. So we want our target file to be a single file which contains employee gender, name, location code, and also the country name. As you can see, both of these information are split into two separate files. So we'll be seeing how we can perform data enrichment task to build our target file. One very important thing which we need to know here is, whenever we are performing or reading data from CSV, we can use recorder processors which performs record level operations. That is more efficient than using other processors. So some of the example of record level processors are lookup record or partition record. These are called record level processors. And also these kind of processors, you have to define what is the schema. So by schema, what I mean is, so for example, in this employee.csv file, what is the schema or what is the structure of this file? So as you know, all the files are stored into binary forms, and we need to know the schema. I mean, what is the, how to read that file? So schema is nothing but description about a file. And also, to efficiently manage schemas, we have something called schema registry. So you can read about schema registry. One link which I found to read about schema registry is from Cloudera. So just to give you a quick introduction about schema registry. A schema registry actually contains all the information about the data which is stored in a file. Okay, now let's say you have a scenario where source system sending you files, and then you process the file and then you send it further. Now let's say suddenly from the source system they performed some migration, and now source system started sending you bad data. And if you do not have a schema configured from your application side which verifies the structure of the file, then you and verifies the schema of the file, then you will not be able to process the data accurately, and your application will stop functioning or it will break. Okay, to avoid these kind of problems, we always hard code the schema of a file which tells about the description of a file. And also there are other advantages of defining schema. So as you can see in this example, they have explained, if you define a schema, then you will be having the data and you will be having a ID which will be pointing to the schema. And if you do not define a schema, then all your payload will be having a schema text along with the data, so which is going to increase the size of the data. So So guys, I do not want to explain schema registry in more detail because that's not the objective of this this tutorial. We probably will be discussing about schema registry in more detail in some other tutorials. In this one, let's focus on reading a CSV file and then performing lookups, and after that we will partition the data based on the country code and send it to the target system. So for first step, I have already created a processor. I'm using a getFile processor. In the getFile processor, I'm defining the location of the file which we want to read. So as you can see, I have already our data is available under this directory. So I have already set my processor to input directory to raw data directory, and also I have set the file filter to employee.csv. So this is the file which we want to read. Other than this, I have also changed keep source file to true. By default it remains false. If you keep it false, after reading the file from the source system will be deleted. We do not want to do that, so I have just made it true. And after that, I have also made some changing in the scheduling part and change the run schedule from 0 second to 60 seconds. So what getFile will do is getFile will read the file and send the data to the next processor. So let's start this processor and see what is the operation performed by this processor. Okay, so as it is showing, it has successfully created or read one file. And so I'm going to stop this processor and let's right click on this queue and see the content of this file. So as you see, the content of this file is similar to what we had here in employees.csv file. So if I do cat command on employee.csv, content is same, which has been read by NiFi. Now in the part 2, I'm updating the attribute. So as we know, attribute is basically the metadata which is associated with a flow file. So if I right click on this queue and if I go here on the left side and click on view details, you'll be seeing there are many attributes which are associated with any file. So you have path name, path directory, file group, and many other information about the file. So along these are the default attributes which we have associated with the file. And let's say if we also want to associate any new attribute to this file, so the method to do that is using update attribute processor. So if you double click on update attribute processor and go to the properties, you will be seeing I have created input definition and output definition. Okay, in the input definition I have written the value of input schema, and in the output definition I have written output schema. So input schema and output schema are, you know, a way where I have described how to read the input file, and when the file is going to be written to the target directory, what is the schema it should refer to. Okay, so I will telling you where we have actually used this value and where I have defined the schema. So for now, you just need to understand that I have updated two values here, input definition and output definition, with the value of input schema and output schema. And now I'm going to the next processor, which is lookup record. If you double click on lookup record, you'll be seeing it has three properties which are very important. First one is record reader, second one is record writer, and third one is lookup services. So whenever a lookup is performed, it needs to know what is the source file and how to read that source file. Okay, so in this scenario, if lookup record is getting the source file from its previous processor, so we must define the schema of the file, because this processor doesn't know how to read a file. So CSV, this processor is going to use CSV reader controller, which is in which we have defined what is the mechanism or what is the schema name it needs to use to read the file. And similarly, record writer is another controller in which we have defined what is the schema name it needs to use to read the write the file. And in the lookup service, we have defined what is the lookup service, what is the file which it needs to use to perform the lookup. Okay, now let's go one by one and see all of these controllers. So I'm first going to click on CSV recorder. And here you see we have all the controllers which we have created. So one is CSV recorder, the other one is CSV record set writer, and the third one is CSV record lookup service. So let's read about CSV reader. In the CSV reader, if you click on settings on view configuration, you'll be seeing we have set schema access registry to use schema name. And also in the schema name, I have set this to a variable which is pointing to input def. If you remember in our step 2, here I have pointed input definition to a value which is called input schema. So here in this controller, I'm using that value. I'm referring to that value. So what it will do is basically it is going to look for this input definition file in a schema registry which is called Avro schema registry. So what is a Avro schema registry? Avro schema registry is a centralized way of storing all the schemas. So as I told you, usually we always use schema registry in order to store all the schemas centrally, because you will be reading thousands of files, and all those thousands of files will be having thousands of different schema, and you don't want to keep hard coding your schemas here and there. So for that purpose we use schema registry, and NiFi provides Avro schema registry, which is very powerful to centralize all the schemas. So to add Avro schema registry, you can just click on this plus sign and then search for Avro schema registry, and then you can click on add. I have already done this step, so I'm just going to demonstrate you what I have done here. In the Avro schema registry, if you click on the configuration, let me disable this first. Right now it is in enable step, so we do not see any additional options. So once it is disabled, then we'll be able to see the additional options. Because if it is working, it is not in an editable mode. So now let's click on configuration. And now you see there is option of adding schema names. When you click on the plus sign, you can add a schema name and also define the structure of the schema. So this is Avro way of specifying a schema. So what I have done here is I have created one property called input underscore schema, and in that input underscore schema, I'm telling it that I have a employee info schema, and in that schema I have three records, and all those three records are of type string. So whenever any record processor is going to perform the operation, I'm going to use input schema name. So if by input schema, they'll always be referring to this schema, and they'll be able to read the file successfully. And similarly, in the output schema, I have created four fields, because as you remember, our target is to produce a final file which will have gender, which will have information of employee name, employee location ID, and also the country name, complete country name. So our target will have four fields, whereas our input schema is having only three fields. And you can define as many schema names as possible. So you can just click on plus, and then you can give like employee salary, and you can then define the schema. So I'll be making a different video on how to, what is the structure of defining Avro schema name. But for now, you just need to remember it is very simple. The first three things which you need to know is you need to provide a name, and you need to provide namespace, and also you need to define type as record. And in the fields, you need to provide name of the field and also the type of the field. This is mandatory. And also Avro schema itself is stored in a JSON format. So as you can see, this whole schema is defined as a JSON format. So that's about Avro schema registry. Now I'm just going to use these names, input schema name and output schema name, whenever I have to refer to any schema. So I'm going to show you now CSV reader. In the CSV reader, you can see in the schema access registry, I have selected use schema name property. And in the schema registry, I have selected that use Avro schema registry. And I have defined all the schema inside this Avro schema registry. So let's go back to CSV reader, this component again. And in the schema name, I have defined a variable which is called input definition. And as you remember, in the update attribute, I have put the value of input schema in input definition variable. So that is how these components are linked with each other. And this is how it is going to behave dynamically. And again, in CSV record set writer is also same. I have put schema.name attribute here, and in the schema access strategy, I have selected use schema name property. And in the schema registry, we again need to point to the same schema registry. So I have selected Avro schema registry. And in the schema name, since this is our output file schema, I have selected output definition. And if you recall, in the output definition, we have put output underscore schema value, which is going to point to the schema which are having four fields as our target. So now I'm going to start this Avro schema registry. And so we discussed about Avro schema registry, we discussed about CSV reader, we discussed about CSV record set writer. Now let's discuss about CSV record lookup service. So if you click on view configuration of CSV record lookup service, you will see that we have a CSV file. So here I need to define the CSV file which is going to be used for lookup. So here if you see, I have given the complete file of the file. Okay, I have given the complete path. And in the lookup key column, you need to define on which column you want to perform the lookup. So if you see the structure of our file, I'm going back on the server to show you the structure of the file. Let me clear the window. So in country CSV, you see we have country code, which contains complete information of a country name. And also in our file, which is employee.csv, we also have location ID. So location ID and country code are same, and these are going to be joined to produce the final output file. So in the lookup key column, I have given country code, and now I'm going to click on OK. So all these services are already in started mode. And since we stopped Avro schema registry, others were stopped in stopped state, so I'm just going to enable them again. Now let's click on lookup record again. So first three properties, record reader, record writer, and lookup services, we already discussed. Now let's look for result record path. Here, if you want to select all the values from the target file, which is countries.csv file in this case, you just need to put slash, and if you want only the selected column, you can give the name of that column along with the slash value. So my file anyways contains only one column, country name, along with country code. So I'm just going to keep it to slash, which means it will pick country name. And if it had additional fields or additional columns in country.csv file, it would have brought that one as well, because I'm in the record result path, I'm giving slash, which means bring all the records. And in the routing strategy, I have selected route to match or unmatch. By default, it is route to success. So I have selected route to match or unmatch, because what we want to do is, let's say if any employee's country information is not found in the country.csv file, then I want to save that file separately in a separate directory. So that's why here I have selected route to match or unmatch. And in the end, now you need to perform a key column information about your source file. So in the source file, which is going to be employee.csv, what is the ID we should be matching with key column? If you remember, in the lookup key column, we have put country code. Now here we need to define in the source file what is the key column which we need to match with. So here, if you see here in the employee.csv, we have location ID, which is the key column. So here, this is the way you need to define it. You need to define it with a slash followed with the column name. And this name here I have given is key, but it can be any name. So the way to create this additional property is by selecting plus symbol here and then giving any name. So it can be any name along with the column name. And also it accepts only one additional property here. So I'm just going to delete this one, because I have already defined one key property. So click on apply. And now if you see here, I have created the relationship of matched and unmatched previously. And for all the unmatched cases, I'm again loading that file using put file processor to a destination directory, which is slash tmp slash unmatched. So let's run this processor until here and see how it works. I'm just going to clear this queue so it removes the previous data. And let's run this again. Let's run this get file. And I'm also going to stop this so it doesn't run again. And in the queue, let's click on list queue and see the data which we have. Okay, it has read the source file, which contains gender information, name information, and location ID. Now let's run update attribute. So guys, just if you click on list queue and if you click on view properties, you will notice right now we do not have any property which is called input definition or output definition. Okay, we not have any attributes. I'm in the update attribute, I'm adding those two additional attributes, input definition and output definition. So once this processor runs, it is going to process this flow file. And now if you right click on list queue and then click on view details, then you will see two new attribute has been added, which is input definition and output definition. And input definition contains the value input schema, and output definition contains the value output schema. So in the input schema, if you remember, we have given input schema in Avro registry, which is this one. Okay, so this is the structure of the file. But this attribute doesn't do anything. It just updates the attribute of a flow file. It doesn't do anything with the flow file. So if you right click here and click on list queue and see the content of the content of the file remains the same, because we have not made any changes in the content of the file. Now I'm going to run lookup record. Let's start lookup record. Okay, so as you can see, after lookup record, there is one flow file which moved to unmatched, and the other route which moved to matched. So let's see the matched one. Right click on this one and click on list view. So matched should have the matched record should have the description of a country name. Okay, so let's click on view content, and here as you see we have all the records along with the actual country name. So this means the lookup is performed successfully. All the records of employee has been successfully performed lookup with countries.csv, and it has brought country name for all the records. And for the record where it could not match and could not bring country name are gone to unmatched routing. So if you right click here and click on list queue, and let's click on view content. So here if you see, these are the files which could not match the country name, and country name information is blank there. So the probably this looks like some junk record which we had in our file. So all these junk record, you know, we want to be seen by someone, and that's why we want this to be moved to some different directory, or let's say on some different server. In this case, we just want to keep it on different directory, which is /temp/unmatched. So in this directory, it would have placed this file after we start this processor. Okay, so let's start this put file processor. And let's go to on the server, let's go to cd/tmp/unmatched directory, and let's do ls-lrt. So you see employee.csv file which has unmatched record has moved to this directory. So let's do a cat operation to see the content of this file, and as you see the content of this file is matching with what we have seen here. Okay, so this is the junk record which has been moved to a different directory. So now you can take separate action on this processor, but for now I have just terminated all the connection here. So all the failure and success I have done self termination. So this processor is not connecting to any other processor. Alright, so now let's see what is happening for the cases where we have successful matched records and where we have successfully brought all the country names. So now let's suppose we want to split this single flow file in multiple flow files based on the country name. So let's say we need to send this file to, you know, different downstream systems, and they want the information related only with the their countries which they're working for. Okay, so in that case we would like to split our file based on the country ID or location ID or country name. So I have used another processor which is called partition record. So let's see the configuration of this partition record. So if you right click on partition record and go to configure, you will see it has record reader and record writer. So on the record reader again, I have given the, you know, schema name which it should read, and in the record writer I have selected CSV record set writer. Okay, so now in the record reader, if you see, I have not used CSV record reader, rather than I have used a separate processor which is called, I have read, even though I am using the same controller services, but I have defined it differently. Okay, so this is a CSV record reader and I have defined it separately. I'll show you. Just click here on this arrow button to click on go to. It will bring us to the controller services. Now here if you see, I have used CSV reader controller. Okay, previously also to read the input, our source file, we have used CSV reader. But this CSV reader, we have defined the schema name. In this CSV reader, I have not defined the schema name. So if you click on view configuration, you will notice in the schema access strategy, I have just selected use string fields from header, because here if I give input schema name, you will notice that our input schema name we have defined only with three fields. And whereas after the lookup, we have one additional column, which is the country name. So here if I use input schema, it is going to read only three records and it is going to ignore a string which is country name. So I don't want to that to happen. So that's why in the schema access strategy, we have selected use string field from header. So it is just going to use the field names, and based on that field names, it is going to automatically decide on the schema name. So that is the only change which I have made here. And then click on OK. Let's go back. Click on partition record, click on configure. And in the record writer, I have still selected CSV record set writer, because if you see the property of this controller, go to CSV record writer and click on view configuration, you will notice in the schema access strategy, we have given use schema name, and in the schema name, we have defined output definition, and we have told it to use schema registry, which is called Avro schema registry. So if you go inside Avro schema registry, and if you see in the output definition, we have defined all the four columns. Okay, so that's the reason while going to write the file to the final time, I'm still using output definition. Now it also requires one more property, which can be anything and which is going to point it to the column by which you want to perform the split operation. Now, as I told you, I wanted to split all my flow file based on the country ID. Okay, so what it will do is it will split all the contents here based on location ID. It will create multiple flow files. So if you see this record, this flow file has around 1939 records. Okay, so now this is going to be splitted into multiple files, and each of the file will have only similar type of country location ID and country name. Okay, it can be any column name on which you want to perform split operation or partition operation. So here I have given location ID, and now if we run it, I'm going to click on success queue. This processor has successfully partitioned the data. So now let's click on this success queue and click on list queue. And in the list queue, now if you see, we have so many flow files. So our file is employee.name. Based on that, this partition process has performed the partition and it has created many flow files. Let's see one of the flow files, and it should have information only related to the person belonging to the similar location ID. So now you see in this flow file, we have all the people belonging to similar location ID. And if we go back and see any other flow file, then that also has information belonging to the similar location ID. So this is how we perform the partitioning. Okay, now next what I am doing is, if you see here, if you noticed, let's right click on list queue, and if you would have noticed here, all the flow files are having same name, which is employee.csv. Okay, so if I write this, if I use put a processor to write this flow file, all my flow files are going to have same name, so that's why it is going to get overwritten. Okay, so what I want is I want to save all the flow files. Okay, so to do that, what we need to do is we need to make this file name unique. So that's why what I have done is I have again used update attribute. And in the update attribute, if you see the configuration, in the update attribute, I have updated file name attribute to file name, and I have also added location ID. Let's see what are these information, file name and location ID. So if you go one level back and you click on the success queue, right click and go to the list queue, you will notice that all these flow files are having two attributes. Okay, one attribute which I have used in that function is file name, and the other one which I have used is location ID. Okay, so these are the two attributes which all of our flow file has. So based on that, I have created a function to use these two attributes to create a unique file name. Okay, now if you again go back to update attribute and select configure, you will notice that I have used both of these attributes, and since we are using the value of the attribute, so this is the syntax to use that. So you have to, whenever you want to use the value of any attribute, you have to define it starting with dollar and then curly braces. Inside the curly brace, you need to write the attribute name. So let's say I want to use the file value of file name, so I'll be giving file name. We'll be having a separate section on how to use these attribute names, and you can also read more about this from NiFi, you know, NiFi documentation. You can go under the expression, using expression syntax and all those stuff, which will give you more understanding about this. Now if you noticed, in this attribute also we have input definition and output definition. However, this is not required this game, because I just copy pasted this update attribute and I just modified a couple of values. So if any of the attributes you want to use again, you can do Control C, Control V. Let's say I want to use log message again, so I can press Control C and Control V. It will copy and paste that processor, then I can double click on that and I can make some changes and adjustment. This is a way to perform faster development. I'm going to delete log message. Okay, so in the update attribute, what I will do is I will delete this input definition and output definition. This is not required. Only thing what we want to do is we want to update the file name from file name to file name, and so all the files are going to have employee.csv, and along with that it is going to have the location ID. So the output file name will be employee.csv followed with location ID and then followed with .csv. Okay, so that's the way it has been written. I have not made any other changes here. So now let's run it and let's click on refresh. Okay, so now let's see what is the output of this. Right click on the success queue and click on list queue. In the list queue, if you see, we have the same number of flow files, and let's click on view details to see the attributes. And now if you see, the file name attribute has been updated with employee.csv underscore location ID. So if you see, location ID was ET, so that location ID has been appended here, and then we have added .csv. This is a way to make this file name unique. Otherwise, after you perform the partition, all the flow files are going to have the same file name. So now I'm using put file processor and writing this file to /tmp/target directory. And if you notice, in the create missing directory, I have set it to true. So let's say if target directory doesn't exist, it is going to create the target directory. Click on OK, and now let's start this processor. Okay, as you can see, this has successfully written all the files and moved the flow files to success queue. So now if we go to the server and go inside, let me clear the screen first. Let's go inside /tmp/target directory. This is the directory where we have written all the files. Let's do ls here. So now after doing the ls, you can see all of our files has been successfully written here with the name employee dot csv and followed with underscore location id dot csv. Let's see the content of one of the file. As you can see here, each flow file now having only the related content. And now these files can be transferred to, you know, any number of targets depending on their need. So this tutorial was very long actually, and also I didn't have time to explain each of the components in much detail. So we'll be discussing about each of the processor in more details in subsequent videos. But I hope it had given you, you know, fair idea about what is the real use case which you are going to perform with NiFi. Also, if you notice, I have created all these processor under data enrichment example processor group. So I'm going to go back to NiFi flow, and if you right click here and if you click on create template, it is going to store this in a template. I have already done this and I have created a template. And if whenever you click create a template, you can manage those templates by clicking here on the templates. In the templates, if you see, I have already created a template which is called data enrichment examples. So whenever I want to use this, or let's say I want to send it to someone, I can go to template. If I want to use it here, I will go on template, I will select this data enrichment example, I will click on add, and this will add this processor group here. So I'll be sharing this template with you. You can download this template, and also I'll be sharing the sample files with you. So you can download the templates and you can download the CSV file, and then you can run this in your NiFi instance and see if it is working successfully. If you have any query, please feel free to write in the comment section. Thanks for watching.